in this edition of Art Loft, Margin of Error.
It's interesting. It's this idea of the voyeur, what accidents happened. You want to see what can occur.
New art at Florida Atlantic University.
And they're coupled with sort of neoclassical architectural remnants. They look like ruins.
Eric Anfinson.
My artwork always has to do with people. I like to paint people.
And Audubon House.
The octavos, the small pieces that you see on the walls, are actually originals as well.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from the studios at WPBT2 in Miami, this is Art Loft. Hi, art lovers. On this episode, we'll make stops in Boca Raton, the Florida Keys, and more. But first, we head over to Miami Beach for a safety tour of the ages. At the Wolfsonian-FIU, Margin of Error aims to chronicle global reactions to catastrophes of engineering, from reports to hindsight-provided safety tips.
Margin of error is really about that small lapse, especially during the Industrial Revolution, between mankind's ability to create and invent and the unexpected outcomes of all those inventions. The range of mediums shown in this exhibition are great, and it's a good representation of our collection. We have a large collection of posters. There are paintings, there are decorative arts objects, and there are material culture objects as well. The first thing that you see as you enter the gallery space is a firebox. This is an old sort of call box. If you saw a fire, you could pull it and alert people that there was a fire. Of course, you have to travel a distance to get to it, so there's some inherent issues with it. The room that we're in right now is really looking at industrial accidents. So it's this idea during the Industrial Revolution, factories began. These amazing technologies and machines were created by mankind, but they also had to watch out for the accidents that could happen because of them. So these posters, we have Belgian, Dutch, Czech, and Italian, look at how to keep the workers safe in the workplace. They're unavoidable accidents that could happen because of the technology that they're using. Another section of this exhibition is entitled Construction, and it's specifically looking at building construction, especially high-rises, which came about during this time period. Not only the time period for the exhibition, but the time period that our museum focuses on. This idea of looking at lonely construction workers up high above the city, there's famous photos of this that you see all the time, where there's groups of men, but to see that sort of single man by himself working on this construction site, it is a lonely view. Some of them are interesting because people that were skilled laborers in unions, you'll notice that they have harnesses. Some men are out there just free that don't have harnesses, and those were itinerant workers. One of the pieces that we have is referred to as a Westinghouse panel. It was from the 1933 Chicago exhibition, showing, again, the technological developments and innovations of 1933, and electricity was part of that exhibition. So that panel is showing Westinghouse's contribution of electricity. Some highlights of this exhibition, I think, are its use of Greek mythology, and you'll see some of the Greek gods in some of the works of art, including Icarus, a famous story of him, the story of Prometheus. You'll also see some famous images of the disasters that we all know, including the Hindenburg, the Zeppelin that crashed, and also the Titanic, of course, the sinking of the Titanic. I think my favorite feedback is from the opening of the show and all the compliments to Matthew Abbas and his writing, and what a great job he did curating the exhibition. I think it's something that people really can attach themselves to. It's interesting. It's this idea of the voyeur, what accidents happened. You want to see what can occur. And it's also still very timely. We still have accidents. We still have this drive as humans to achieve bigger and better things with technology. I also think that we've gotten really positive feedback on the design of the show. I think it's beautifully laid out. It's a bit stark, but I think that that really reflects some of the stark nature of the images in the show. And the great thing is, even if you're a big fan of the Wolfsonian and you've seen our exhibitions before, we're pulling from the vaults here. We've got a lot of great objects out that are not often seen.
For the events and exhibits calendar for the Wolfsonian-FIU, visit wolfsonian.org. Up next on Art Loft.
The subjects that I'm intrigued by have something to say. Sometimes it's more than just their expression physically.
University galleries at Florida Atlantic University opened their exhibition season with new art, literally. New Art, South Florida Cultural Consortium Visual and Media Artists Fellowship Exhibition is the work of 12 grant-winning Florida artists. Their goal, to bring attention to issues in contemporary art.
We are in the Schmidt Center Gallery, where we have South Florida Cultural Consortium Media and Visual Arts Fellowship Exhibition. So the artists are selected by this panel, and we have the pleasure of working with each of the artists to decide what they will put in the exhibition. The artist's only obligation of the fellowship or grant is to participate in this exhibition, and we have place their work in both of our galleries, the Schmidt Center Gallery, where we are right now, and the Ritter Art Gallery. The artists in the exhibition include the artist Lucinda Linderman, and she and Carrie Phillips, another artist in the exhibition, use or repurpose materials found in the trash can or in other places that have been taken out of use. L'Oreal Beltram, who is both a painter and a sculptor, who also has two works in the exhibition that are made from granite countertops that came out of defunct condominium projects in Miami, and they're coupled with sort of neoclassical architectural remnants. They look like ruins. So in the exhibition, Dara Friedman is one of the artists that has won the grant, and it is at least her second time winning the grant. And her work includes dance, one of them, in the Ritter Art Gallery. Stravinsky's Rite of Spring is the music for the piece, and there are two dancers who are both sort of formally dancing, but also kind of emoting, grunting and groaning a little bit. And so there are things that maybe we would think are not supposed to be happening on camera that are happening indeed on camera. So another artist in the exhibition who came and created an installation on site is Alistair Eves. So she created a version or a testament or of her childhood, her adolescent bedroom. And it's very dark. various kind of low light sources, and she actually asks in the entrance of the space for viewers to disrobe before they go in the room. In her words, that's the way she experienced her adolescent bedroom most of the time, and so she's encouraging viewers to do that. So one of the artists in the exhibition is Sylvia Lazima. She's an artist from Broward County, and she makes hand-painted photographs. And the way that she presents them in a circular frame, and also her soft palette in painting them, to me they're kind of reminiscent of Renaissance pictures, you know, and for the reasons that these statues obviously relate to European traditions, but in something that is maybe, it's kind of humorous perhaps relative to the scale, but also very heartfelt in terms of how we embellish our homes. Another artist in the exhibition is Gonzalo Fuenmayor. His images are a little bit subversive, both in terms of what we might think about decorative Latin American scenarios, palm trees, banana trees, and also perhaps the way Latin America is viewed in the movies, specifically in two images that he has in the exhibition. One is an image called, or the words Colombia itself are part of the picture, but it is spelled Colombia in the Latin way as opposed to the European way, I suppose, that Colombia Pictures is. So one of the things that's always exciting about this exhibition, because we have had the pleasure of presenting it multiple times beginning in 2000, is that the artists that we invite to come and make works, oftentimes we collaborate with them by getting art students to help them install their work or literally make the work. And it's such a terrific collaboration with a practicing professional artist and an art student, and it is something that is unique and germane, I believe, to a university gallery.
For more on the university galleries at Florida Atlantic University, visit fau.edu/galleries. And remember, share your creations and collection photos with us at Art Loft SFL. Up next on Art Loft.
My duties as a resident artist here is very simple. I paint my paintings in my studio, I frame them, I photograph them, and I bring them in to these wonderful people.
Now we head down to Key West in the Florida Keys. First stop, the Mockingbird Studio. There, fine artist Eric Anfinson discusses his process and the inspirations behind several of his works. Enjoy.
Key West on a trip to get out of another town, and then ended up loving it, so I stayed. I had moved from Colorado, where I was for about a decade before that, and then I moved to Key West about full time about 12 to 13 years ago. Always has to do with people. I like to paint people, not specific people necessarily. I look for a universal quality. I'm not a portrait artist in the traditional sense. I don't really want to do the likeness. That's not important to me. What's important to me is the story behind it, the meaning behind it that's going to come through eventually. There are artists who kind of see people as props. That's not a negative thing, that's just they don't want any input. Sometimes that is important not to have input. And sometimes you get some good stuff. because the subjects that I'm intrigued by have something to say. Sometimes it's more than just their expression physically. The subject matter that I depend on has to do with a combination of real people and the imaginary. I use real people as inspiration and as a template of sorts. That might be physical, that might be an emotional response, that might be a number of different factors. The things that happen after they leave or after when I'm alone with the canvas, that's where the magic, so to speak, happens. My process of painting is somewhat haphazard. I stumble onto an idea. I stumble onto a person that intrigues me. I stumble onto many things throughout the day. It's a matter of how does that flesh out in a painting? And the paintings always change. I know some people, some artists have, they know what it's going to look like at the end before they even finish. I don't have a clue. And I'm part of the process that way. And it's exciting to me because each day I get to find out a little something more. My most recent piece that you're asking about is called This Side of Eden. And it's a person that I've painted many times, and every time is different, which is great, which is why I keep painting this person, because it's very, very rich and fertile ground. I did an experiment. Normally I can't listen to anything with words, music-wise, when I'm painting. This time I purposely listened to the book East of Eden, which happened to be the subject's very favorite book. So I listened to this book as I painted, and I found that it was quite helpful, actually. It developed the story around her. It included the books. It included the elements of the garden and Eden in the literary sense of this book. And I think that it feels like a new level. It feels like a meeting of skill versus intention. The response to my work has been very, very good. The first painting I sold was the first painting I showed, and so it had paid for my rent the first time I went through the door. So the response has been very good. I'm a self-trained painter. I started painting aggressively when I got down here to Key West, and it has been a very nurturing, if I could say that, experience. My favorite painting is always the next one. And that's, I think that says more about the process than anything else. I've painted hundreds of these paintings, and each one is very important to me, in different levels for different reasons. The amount of time that you spend with this this subject, this painting, is quite a great deal. Plus, it's very intimate. And so, if you're going to spend your time painting it, it better be worthwhile. And it's not for anybody other than myself that I paint these. And I think that's what people relate to. But my favorite subject is always my next one. That's the most fun. And I think that's what I look forward to. I've only been painting 10 years now, and quite a body of work. But I think what feeds that is the fact that I look forward to tomorrow more than anything else.
For more about Anfinson, including recent works and appearance announcements, visit ericanfinson.com. Next week on Art Loft.
So much of what the dancers are pulling from the movement is coming from the music.
American naturalist John James Audubon visited the Florida Keys in the 1830s, creating a beautiful visual record of the area's flora and fauna. The Audubon House Gallery holds a collection of these works and is a source of inspiration for one local painter.
John James James Audubon came to the Florida Keys in 1832. He painted 22 birds, and some of them were the more iconic ones that we know. For example, the flamingo, the roseate spoonbill, the brown pelican. Audubon had a vision. He wanted to do something that had really never been done before, was to create a field guide of birds where the birds would be life-size in their natural environments. They were a process of a copper engraving, and they were all hand-colored after that according to the specifications of Mr. Audubon. And when you go into the house, you're actually going to see an artist proof of the white-crowned pigeon, which was done in the Florida Keys. The Geiger tree flower is on that print, and this artist proof is something that Audubon himself basically touched. The gallery itself carries original antique hand-colored lithographs and engravings of Audubon's, dating anywhere between 1827 all the way through to the 1870s. The gallery is part of the grounds of the Audubon House. The property is approximately an acre. Audubon never set foot in that house. She was actually constructed after his visit. She was built after the hurricane of October 1846, and we know that Audubon came in 1832, which makes it impossible for him to have stayed here. The house was nearly destroyed in the 1950s. It was saved from becoming a gas station by the Wolfsons, who ended up restoring the house, bringing it back to her former glory, and purchasing all these 22 birds, these original pieces of artwork, to commemorate Audubon's visit. Audubon basically worked in watercolors. The octavos, the small pieces that you see on the walls, are actually originals as well, because Audubon decided to bring it to an eighth of the size to make it more affordable. When people come in, they're always looking for a spoonbill. They love all pelicans. And quite frankly, one of the prettiest matchings that Audubon ever did in terms of his prints are the white and the brown pelican. In the case of the Carolina parakeet, which is the only parrot he ever painted and which is extinct, the bird ate cockleburrow. So the painting is going to have the cockleburrow along with the birds.
I love John James Audubon's work. I was approached by the curator of Audubon House and was asked to show, and I jumped on the chance. I paint birds, all kinds of birds, especially parrots. My duties as a resident artist here is very simple. I paint my paintings in my studio, I frame them, I photograph them, and then bring them in to these wonderful people, and they hang them.
Over the last 8 years, tremendous care has been done in order to reacquire pieces that were historically correct and to tell the true story of the Geigers. So we actually have a spyglass of his, and we have his glasses. And those pieces to us are just very heartwarming and important. Walk away with the knowledge of how an extremely wealthy family lived in the Florida Keys in the mid-19th century. And we want them to feel as though they came to an oasis of tranquility, of learning.
For more about this gallery, visit audubonhouse.org. And for details on artist Cynthia Culp, visit cynthiaculp.com. Thanks so much for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Visit WPBT2.org/ArtLoft to watch past episodes. And you can get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. All right, here we go with the outro. One, three, two, one. I was like, one, two, three. And come on, ride that train. Just ride it. Just a little bit of love. A little bit. Just a little bit. Which one? Literally. Beat. Can I say beat? I got a song for everything, right? Your goal should have been a question, but the inflection was a little off. Okay. You should be asking a question. Everybody do the wave, do the wave, do the wave. Yeah. You know what? You guys are so silly.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners.